Wageningen University and Research has developed many technologies in the field of circular bio-based economy. In this video series, we will look at how these technologies are introduced to the market and reflect on some of the specific challenges that we faced.
An innovation that started in Wageningen University ultimately led to a 75,000 ton plant in Thailand. I'm Jan Noordegraaf, a graduate of Delft Technical University in metallurgy. I've worked for Simbra for almost 20 years now, and I'm managing director of this location, which is now part of the Baby Simbra Raw entity, which is part of the Baby Simbra Group with a head office in Stockholm. We produce here several products. We make, our main product is expandable polystyrene, raw material for that, which is used, for instance, to make insulation for houses or packaging for fish, but we also produce radio wave absorbers, which is a very special product, polystyrene strips for to use inside concrete casting systems, and we also have the product, it's called Biofoam, which was developed together with Wageningen University, and we have all the production of this material also on this location.
For Baby Simbra, we develop Biofoam, and Biofoam is an expandable bead foam based on polylactic acid instead of polystyrene. Polylactic acid is based on renewable resources. And in this case, it's based on sugarcane, but you can use any other crop containing a large amount of starch or sugar, for example, corn or even sugar beet.
And the sugar is extracted by companies like Corbion. They make lactic acid out of that.
And lactic acid is converted into lactite.
That light white powder is melted in our factory where we make polylactic acid polymer, polylactic polymer.
For a foam product, it's really important that you have very small particles, because if you foam them, they will expand about 40 times.
And we can add color. You can add brown or white or black.
The granules contain a gas, and if we heat it, it will expand, just like you make popcorn.
The material expands to a very light foam. It's then extremely light. We then apply a coating on it, which has been developed by Wageningen University, because we have to glue this, the things together. And then we put it again in the machine with a little bit of CO2 in the foam beads, and we mold the products.
Like, for example, this tray.
Then this molded product is used. It ultimately ends up either mechanically recycling, which is a technical recycling, or you can compost it, then it is a plant-based recycling. And when you then have compost, you can use it again to grow plants. And that basically completes the circle. Biodegradable foam will not, on the short term, replace all the fossil foam, simply because the available capacity is not large enough. So we took it upon ourselves to find their applications where it brings the largest benefit. And then when you start looking, you cannot just simply replace material. You have to look at other materials. And what is very important, you have to get into contact with people that do not have a narrow vision, but have a wide vision. They are around, you can find them, it's not easy. They are not the people that buy raw material, they are purchasers. I will no longer speak to purchasers, but only when we have spoken to the sustainability officer or the CEO, who see the big picture. This is a development which was done on behalf of IKEA. We are actually approved by IKEA and not allowed to put it on the website, because otherwise all suppliers of IKEA would put it on the website, but I can't tell it to you. And this means that at the end of 2020, IKEA wants to have no EPS packaging anymore. They have decided to do that. So then it is, what's then the alternative? We have this alternative. We have been approved by IKEA for 3 years ago, and now we are working with several white good producers in Italy, and we have made prototypes for packaging of an oven. What we now are doing is to organize the end of life. The end of life, if it is composting, you have to use a new way of thinking of getting reverse logistics in place. That means you have to reach out to a lot of stakeholders before you even sell a new product. And what we now have done, we have demonstrated in Switzerland and in the Netherlands, and in the Netherlands with the help of composting experts of Wageningen University, that our material composts extremely well. And what we're now doing is when you have refrigerators and you buy one, you have cardboard, you have wood, you have packaging, everything is taken back by the supplier. They go to so-called collection hubs. And in these collection hubs, they already were circular a long time ago. They separate the packaging in plastic, wood, old refrigerators, EPS and biofoam. And then we collect full truckloads, and then it can go either to a local composting facility, which we have organized on the European level, or we can recycle it depending on where the material is and how far the transport distance is. And actually, we now have to face the question, how long do you want it to sustain? We can set the life of the polymer, which is a unique capability, and then the people have to think, yeah, how long do I want it to survive? So it shows that you have to look for applications whereby degradability and sustainability bring a benefit. And they are around. So it means you really have to think much further than only selling a product. You have to really involve yourself in the end of life. And there is a lot of opposition. People do not want to change because they have a comfortable life. But that period is over. We will not only have a comfortable life if we change our way of working completely. And that's what we have to do. And that's also what students in the future have to do. You think you have no influence, but you have more influence than you think. You can change the way of working we do as a society. And it starts with you.